Shabbat Shalom.
That's not Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom medley.
Sounds like
a Hallelujah. They sound a lot alike in the beginning, huh? Shabbat, we might as well do a Shabbat Shalom medley. Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat, 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 Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat, 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 Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat, 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 Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat, Shabbat. Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat Shalom. Come, house of Jacob. Walk in the light. been studying about the festivals. We've talked about spring festivals, the fall festivals. We've talked about Purim. We've talked about Hanukkah. And last night we talked about Rosh Chodesh and the marking of the months. And in all of this, we've left out what is considered the primary festival. The very important one. The most important, because it is the first one that was ever given. And all of the other festivals are built on a foundation of a cycle that God set up at creation. The cycle of the seventh day and the rest on that seventh day. There are, in the listing of the scripture, in the listing of the festivals, in Leviticus 23, the first one mentioned is actually the Sabbath. Who has Leviticus 23, 1 through 3 to read?
I do. The Lord spoke again to Moses, saying, "Speak to the sons of Israel, and say to them, the Lord's appointed times, which you shall proclaim as holy convocations, my appointed times are these. For 6 days work may be done, but on the seventh day there is a Sabbath of complete rest, a holy convocation. You shall not do any work. It is a Sabbath to the Lord in all your dwellings."
These are the feasts. And he begins with, there are 6 days, but the seventh day is the Sabbath. The Sabbath is listed before any other festivals, and it was actually given before any others also. You see, God wants to meet with us once a month. He wants to meet with us at the primary, at the other festivals. But the very first one given in Leviticus is actually the Sabbath day itself. And historically, the Sabbath was the first given. Genesis 2, 1 through 3.
"Thus the heavens and the earth were completed, and all their hosts. By the seventh day, God completed his work which he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had done. Then God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because in it he rested from all his work which God had created and made."
So God himself set it up from the very beginning. Historically, we look at the fact that Sabbath remembers the creation. It remembers that when God created, he stepped back and he looked and he said, "It was good. It is good." He said, "It is good." He didn't rest because he was tired. But he did rest in a kick back and enjoy it kind of day. He stopped creating and just enjoyed what he had created. Historically, that is the basis of the Sabbath day. That's where it starts. That's where it will end, actually, even with creation. Prophetically, we know that it is still in effect. Hebrews 4, 9 through 10.
"So there remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God. For the one who has entered his rest has himself also rested from his works, as God did from his."
So there are those who will say that Yeshua came and he did away with the Sabbath. I will speak to you and I will tell you that Yeshua is resting from his work, and he expects us to rest from ours too. That there is a day, there is a time. We are to cease from our work to remember him, to honor him. Yeshua said, "Come unto me, all you who are weary, and I will give you rest." It doesn't have to do with just good sleep at night. It has to do with recognizing and walking after that, of knowing that God's rest is for us even today. There's a time to rest. There's a need to rest. There was a pastor, it's been quoted as saying that, "But I have to work. I'm going to keep working. I got to work 7 days a week because the enemy works 7 days a week." And my answer to that is, I think you have the wrong person you're following. Because God rested. Yes, the enemy is at work 7 days a week. We understand that. I know that. But I'm not supposed to model my life after the enemy. I model my life after Messiah. I model my life after God. And God rested on the seventh day. Spiritually, there's a real strong application in Psalms 37, 7 through 9.
Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. Do not fret because of him who prospers in his way, because of the man who carries out wicked schemes. Cease from anger and forsake wrath. Do not fret. It leads only to evildoing. For evildoers will be cut off, but those who wait for the Lord, they will inherit the land.
There's a place where we are told we need to rest. We need to wait on the Lord. We need to trust him in it. Yes, the enemy works 24/7. But God said, take a day off. Do I trust the enemy or do I trust him? Do I fret over those with wicked schemes who seem to be doing better because they work harder and they're working through it all? Or do I trust God and I say, okay, you said to rest. I'm going to do it. Traditionally, there are steps from the Kiddush on Friday night to the Havdalah on Saturday evening that help us set the time apart as special, help us to figure out how we can rest in the Lord. How do we enjoy God? Part of what's done for Shabbat is the convocation or the assembly, getting everyone together so we can enjoy him together. Isaiah 66:23, I have to find it. Isaiah 66:23 says this, and it will come to pass that from one new moon to another, and from one Shabbat to another, all flesh will come to bow down before me, says Adonai. Everyone will recognize, will celebrate the Sabbath. Everyone will recognize Shabbat. Everyone will honor God in Shabbat when it comes time for the kingdom. So why don't we learn to do it now? Biblically, there are specific things that we're supposed to do to help us to keep the day. Exodus 20, 8 through 11.
Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. But the seventh day is a Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter, your male or your female servant, or your cattle or your sojourner who stays with you. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy.
God blessed Yom Shabbat, the day of Sabbath. He says we are to remember it and we are to keep it holy. Holy means set apart. It means different. It means not common. So how do we keep it different? Well, the first thing it says here is not to do any work. To rest. To recharge physically, emotionally, spiritually. Rest. Don't do the work. Don't burden your donkey. Don't make your servants work for you. Rest. It's seen as a gift, not a burden. You see, God knows us and he knows our tendencies in the flesh. There's always that one more thing to be done. I heard a really cute acronym for the word busy, B-U-S-Y, right? Busy, being under Satan's yoke. B-U-S-Y, busy. You know, if he can't cause us to sin, he can cause us to be so busy that we don't spend any time with God. And that is a sin too. It's said that more than the Jews have preserved the Sabbath is what has preserved the Jews. More than the Jews preserving Sabbath, the Sabbath has preserved the Jews. It is in the keeping of Shabbat, the keeping of the Sabbath, that these things are seen, that they have been made and marked as a different people, as special, as unique. Mark 2:27 tells us that Yeshua said this. Then he said to them, Shabbat or Sabbath was made for man, not man for Sabbath. The Son of Man is Lord, even of the Sabbath. The Son of Man, Yeshua, is Lord, even of the Sabbath. That does not mean that we get to violate it. Does not mean he got to violate it. But that it was created for us, not against us. It was created for our good, not for evil, not for bad. It was created for our benefit. Sabbath was made for man. It was made as a gift to us. Keeping of Sabbath is part of the Ten Commandments. We read in Exodus 20, she read a part of that. And in the Ten Commandments, we've got the first three of the commandments are vertical. They're commandments between us and God. The fifth through the tenth are kind of horizontal. They're between us and others, how we respond to others. But that fourth one right in the middle, that's a hinge. It's a hinge commandment. We've got the first three that keep us right with God, the five through ten that keep us right with each other, but the fourth, right in the middle, becomes a hinge. The number four in prophecy refers to the earth and to creation. The four comes, we look at it this way, there's four corners, right? There's the north, the south, the east, and the west. There's four seasons, winter, spring, summer, and fall, which we just began here. There's four elements. There's four in the New Jerusalem. It said it's the city built four square. Four is a foundational number. It's a foundation. And so the fourth commandment becomes a foundation for our relationships. It sets apart a special time for God and a special time in relationships with others because we extend the rest to them as well. So that is a commandment that goes both directions. It is vertical in that we honor God, but it's horizontal in that we honor those around us as well. The fourth commandment, honor the Sabbath day. Keep it holy. For those who say it is just for the Jews, well, there's a part of that that may be accurate because there was a keeping of Sabbath that was given to them as a sign, as a seal, as a promise. But Yeshua said the Sabbath was made for man. And he used a word that literally means mankind, all mankind. He didn't say the Sabbath was made for us as Jews. He didn't say the Sabbath was made for Judah or the Sabbath was made for Israel. He didn't say that. He said the Sabbath was made for man. Besides, there was no Israel when God created the earth. It wasn't in existence yet. And yet he still set aside the seventh day. Isaiah 56:2-7. Who has that?
How blessed is the man who does this, and the son of man who takes hold of it, who keeps from profaning the Sabbath and keeps his hand from doing any evil. Let not the foreigner who has joined himself to the Lord say, the Lord will surely separate me from his people. Nor let the eunuch say, behold, I am a dry tree. For thus says the Lord, to the eunuchs who keep my Sabbaths and choose what please me and hold fast my covenant, to them I will give in my house and within my walls a memorial and a name better than that of sons and daughters. I will give them an everlasting name which will not be cut off. Also the foreigners who join themselves to the Lord, to minister to him and to love the name of the Lord, to be his servants, everyone who keeps from profaning the Sabbath and holds fast my covenant, even those I will bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be acceptable on my altar. For my house will be called a house of prayer for all the peoples.
So when someone tells you Sabbath is made just for the Jews or just for Israel, you can take them to Isaiah 56 and you can show them. It says here, the foreigners who joined themselves. It even says the eunuchs. A eunuch was one who had been dedicated to one of the false gods. When that eunuch decided he wanted to serve Yahweh, God Almighty, God said, I will accept you. I will let you join with my people. I will bring you into my house. There is a place where in the temple, in the tabernacle, it was forbidden that one who had been made a eunuch or one who had physical deformities of that nature was not allowed to walk in, not allowed to be in the temple. That had to do with the fact that they can no longer produce life. And because they can't produce life, they're a representation of death. And death is not welcome in the presence of God. Death is the last enemy. But God says, even you, I will accept if you will come. If you will come. If we will honor Sabbath, God will honor us. Even as Gentiles, even as foreigners, even if we are not perfect, we still can honor Sabbath, and God will honor us. It's the only commandment, by the way, that says we're to remember it. All the other commandments are do this, don't do this. But for Sabbath, it says remember the Sabbath. Remember. Why? I think because we have a tendency to forget. It's one we forget about. It's one we put away. It's one we think, oh, that's not important. It can't be that important. It's not that essential. So what we'll do is we'll just work right through it, work right past it. It's okay. But we are supposed to remember and keep the Sabbath. We remember it by being reminded of it, but we remember it when we keep it. We keep it by various things like doing no work. Deuteronomy 5, 12 through 15.
Observe the Sabbath day to keep it holy, as the Lord your God commanded you. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall not do any work, your son or your daughter or your male servant or your female servant, or your ox or your donkey or any of your cattle or your sojourner who stays with you, so that your male servant and your female servant may rest as well as you. You shall remember that you were a slave in the land of Egypt, and the Lord your God brought you out of there by a mighty hand and by an outstretched arm. Therefore the Lord your God commanded you to observe the Sabbath day.
Leviticus 26, 13 says this, I am Adonai your God, who brought you forth out of the land of Egypt so that you would not be their slaves, and I have broken the bars of your yoke and made you walk upright. Exodus 31, 13 through 15.
But as for you, speak to the sons of Israel, saying, you shall surely observe my Sabbaths, for this is a sign between me and you throughout your generations, that you may know that I am the Lord who sanctifies you. Therefore you are to observe the Sabbath, for it is holy to you. Everyone who profanes it shall surely be put to death, for whoever does any work on it, that person shall be cut off from among his people. For 6 days work may be done, but on the seventh day there is a Sabbath of complete rest, holy to the Lord. Whoever does any work on the seventh day shall surely be put to death.
Do no work on the Sabbath. I think he makes it pretty clear. Why not do any work on the Sabbath? Why did he put it that way? It says to remember that we were slaves in Egypt. Do slaves get to rest? Do slaves ever get to relax? Do they ever get to just sit and listen to the trees and the wind blowing in the trees or the river and the water going past? Do they ever get to really take a full break? No, they don't. Slaves aren't allowed that. But we are not slaves anymore. We are not slaves to the world anymore. So we show that by resting on the Sabbath. Do no work. But what is work? You know, what some people think of as work, I see as fun. And what some people see as fun, I see as work. I have friends that really love to garden, and they love to get out there and pull the weeds, and they love to work the soil, and they enjoy it, and it's restful to them, and it's fun. And I look at that and I go, that's hard work. I do not like pulling weeds. That's work. It doesn't make me feel good. It doesn't help me feel better about myself. And some people wouldn't understand. There are things that I like to do that they wouldn't want to do. I love to practice the piano. I know that sounds weird, but I love to practice at it. I love to sit down and play. I love to mess around with chords. I enjoy doing that. And I remember when I didn't like to practice, I thought it was work. But I've learned that it's not. For me, that's fun. So what for me is fun and relaxing, for you may be considered work. For someone else, might be different too. So how do we define work? Is there a community definition of work? Traditionally, the rabbis determined that work could be defined by that which was done in order to build the tabernacle. Because they were told in the building of the tabernacle that on the seventh day they were to cease from all that work. So even the most important thing they were doing as a group, building the tabernacle, was to be stopped on the Sabbath day. They were to rest. And so they look at what was needed to be done for the building of the tabernacle, and they come up with 39 specific prohibitions. 39 specific prohibitions that are related directly to the tabernacle. And if they had to stop building the tabernacle, then these are the things they had to stop. It's called the Melachot, the 39 things, the Sabbath laws. The Melachot are divided into six groups based according to the Mishkan's activities in which they're associated. The first group is the field work, that which you had to do in the field in order to help put the tabernacle together. That means sowing the seed, plowing the ground, reaping any of the harvest, binding the sheaves together, threshing your work, winnowing the grain, selecting even the grain, grinding it, sifting it, kneading it, and baking. Those are all considered field work related to the Mishkan, and they're all considered work that is not to be done in our homes. It's not to be done. Then there's the making of the material curtains. That's the second category. Making the material curtains meant you had to shear the wool, clean the wool, comb the wool, dye it, spinning, stretching the threads out, making the loops, weaving the threads, separating the threads, tying a knot or untying a knot, sewing and tearing. Those are all considered things that are work, according to rabbinical understanding, because those were things they did for the tabernacle. Making the leather curtains. Well, to make the leather curtains, they had to trap the animal, slaughter the animal, skin the animal, tan the animal skin, smooth it out, make ruling lines on it, and cut it out. So we can't do any of those things. We can't trap animals, slaughter, skinning, tanning, soothing, make ruling lines, or cut. Okay? Then there's the making of the beams of the Mishkan, which I'm still not sure I understand how this works, but they said to make the beams of the Mishkan, you had to write with a pen or a scroll, writing and erasing. So basically, it's kind of making the marks and then erasing it when it was wrong or making another mark. So writing and erasing what you write is considered one of the things of work on the Sabbath. Now, this is according to traditional Judaism. The putting up or the taking down of the Mishkan or the tabernacle. So we're not supposed to build anything or break anything down. We're not supposed to put it up. We're not supposed to take it down. And then there's all the final touches, of course, for there to be a worship time at the Mishkan or at the tabernacle. You had to kindle a fire or extinguish and extinguish fires. You had to strike with a hammer blow, and you had to carry it. So carrying things, striking with a hammer, kindling a fire, or putting out the fire. These are the 39 melachot, the 39 primary prohibitions that has been established by the rabbinical council. Those are all things that if you are Jewish and you're going to honor Shabbat in the traditional way, you want to not be doing on Sabbath. There were other prohibitions that came about later or that are repeated in other places. But I want us to remember something about Sabbath. Isaiah 58:13-16. Who has that?
Because of the Sabbath, you turn your foot from doing your own pleasure on my holy day and call the Sabbath a delight, the holy day of the Lord honorable, and honor it, desisting from your own ways, from seeking your own pleasure, from speaking your own word. Then you will take delight in the Lord, and I will make you ride on the heights of the earth, and I will feed you with the heritage of Jacob your father, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken.
The verse that precedes what he just read says, some of you, and this is a prophetic word that Isaiah was giving to the people, knowing that they were going to go into exile and then some would come back. And it says, some of you will rebuild the ancient ruins, raise up the age-old foundations, will be called repairers of the breach, restorers of the streets for dwelling. And if you turn your back from the Sabbath, from doing your pleasure on my day, and call it delight, the holy day of Adonai honorable, if you'll seek it, not going your own way, then you will delight in Adonai, and then he will let us ride the heights of the earth and feed from the heritage of our father Jacob. A lot of people want to be the restorers of the ruins. A lot of people want to raise up the old foundations, but they don't want to go back to Sabbath. They don't want to honor or recognize that this is God's day. The Shabbat is God's day, and it's not Sunday, it's Sabbath. He's saying here that you need to really search it out and ask him. Don't be searching your pleasure on his day. Search out what his pleasure for you is. It's supposed to be a delight, though. We can't just keep doing it our own way. We're supposed to find a way to find joy in the Lord. For some, that will mean honoring and learning and honoring the melachot. For others, that will mean just taking a hard look at ourselves and saying, what do I need to do? Because, you know, we also recognize, and Yeshua said, the priests worked on Shabbat. There were sacrifices that were done in the temple on Shabbat once it was established. So there's a place where we have to ask the Lord, what is this and what am I to do and what am I not to do? Jeremiah 17:27 gives us another thing that was forbidden.
But if you do not listen to me to keep the Sabbath day holy by not carrying a load and coming in through the gates of Jerusalem on the Sabbath day, then I will kindle a fire in its gates and it will devour the palaces of Jerusalem and not be quenched.
So God is telling them, don't carry burdens in and out of the city of Jerusalem. Why would someone carry burdens in and out of the city of Jerusalem? Usually to set up shop. Usually because they hadn't planned ahead. Why would we carry it in on Sabbath? Because we didn't bring it in on Friday like we should have. Or maybe because they wanted to set up in the city and sell the material. But it says we're not supposed to carry a load through the gates of the city. This is where it's believed and understood that you can carry within your own house, but you may not carry outside of your house. And in Jewish quarters today, that's part of why they live together. Because you see, if you're my brother and you live next to me, then I can carry from my house to your house because you're my brother and our house is extended, the same house. But if there's a Gentile that lives between us, I can't carry from my house to your house. Because then it's going through someone else's property, and they consider that going through the gates of a city. Sometimes I look at what's been determined and I think, I don't know that I would have reached the same conclusion. What we do know is that God told Jeremiah to tell the people to stop carrying things in and out of Jerusalem, to begin to honor his day, or Jerusalem was going to be burned. And it was. Nehemiah 13, 15 through 18.
In those days I saw in Judah some who were treading wine presses on the Sabbath and bringing in sacks of grain and loading them on donkeys, as well as wine, grapes, figs, and all kinds of loads, and they brought them into Jerusalem on the Sabbath day. So I admonished them on the day they sold food. Also men of Tyre were living there who imported fish and all kinds of merchandise, and sold them to the sons of Judah on the Sabbath, even in Jerusalem. Then I reprimanded the nobles of Judah and said to them, "What is this evil thing you are doing by profaning the Sabbath day? Did not your fathers do the same, so that our God brought on us and on this city all this trouble? Yet you are adding to the wrath on Israel by profaning the Sabbath."
So harvesting, processing, bringing it to market, selling and buying, these are all things that, according to verse 18, is profaning the Sabbath. Many in trying to apply all of this, will look in different angles, different ways. The word says not to kindle a fire on the Sabbath day. So the rabbinical understanding in many congregations is that that means you can't start a car or turn on an electric light, because to start the car, there is a spark that is created. To turn on a light, a spark is created. That is a kindling of a fire. There's an attempt, the desire is to put a hedge of protection around the command so that we don't violate the command. Sometimes as much as we put hedges out, as far as we put it out, it does become a burden instead of a blessing. I read recently, and I was really grateful to hear it and to see it in a certain way, that any time we look at the do not, do not, do not, do not of Torah, if there is a do it command, that takes precedence. So the positive command takes priority over a negative command. There's a positive command that on Shabbat we are to have a holy convocation. That means we are to gather together to praise God. We are to gather together on Shabbat. That's a positive command. So the negative command of not kindling a fire, meaning we can't start our car, if we have to start a car in order to go and have the convocation, we look at it from the positive command overrules the negative command. I thought that was a really interesting way to view it. I'd never heard that before. That's a recent thing I just learned, and I'm still trying to figure it out. How does that apply? How does that work? The positive command always takes precedence over a negative command. And I've talked about this before in terms of all of the commandments. There's 613 commandments, but they all fall under two categories. One is love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, and all your might. Love your neighbor as yourself. They all fall underneath those two. Loving God, loving your neighbor. So that if the commandment is to love, and if what you are doing is required for love, then that takes priority over any of the do nots of any of these commandments. It's not to be a burden. Sometimes I try to avoid all of the do nots unless it's specifically in the Bible, because I don't want to add burdens to myself or to anyone else. But I'm really appreciating understanding that the positive command always outweighs a negative command. And this is how Jesus taught, how Yeshua taught, and how he acted when he was clarifying things about the Sabbath. Honestly, he never never violated the Sabbath day. He did not. I don't care who tells you he did. He didn't. If he had violated the Sabbath day, that would have been sin, correct? If he had ever sinned, would he be the perfect sacrifice? No. So that means he could not have violated the Sabbath day in any way, shape, or form. He kept it perfectly. He supported the concept of Sabbath being a day of joy and being a day for mankind. He healed on the Sabbath day to the point of even having a man pick up his bed and walk. It was within the city. It was within the city. So carrying a burden, he was not carrying it outside the city gates. He was carrying it in the city. He was following the command. He showed by his actions that life and health are more important than legalistic do's and don'ts, especially the legalistic keeping of extended laws for the Sabbath. He spoke for life and love and joy and health. He supported the disciples in what they did when they did something they needed to do to feed themselves. In Matthew chapter 12, this is one I have, which is probably not a bad thing. In Matthew chapter 12, beginning in verse 1, at that time, Yeshua went through the grain fields on Shabbat. His disciples, being hungry, began to pluck heads of grain and eat them. But when the Pharisees saw this, they said, "Look, your disciples are doing what is not permitted on Shabbat." And he said, "Haven't you read what David did when he became hungry and those with him? How he entered into the house of God and they ate the showbread, which was not permitted for them to eat, nor for those with him, but only for the Kohanim, the priests. Haven't you read in the Torah that on Shabbat the Kohanim in the temple break the Sabbath and yet are innocent? But I tell you, something greater than the temple is here. If you had known what this means, 'I desire mercy, not sacrifice,' you would not condemn the innocent. For the Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath." And leaving from there, he went into a synagogue. A man with a withered hand was there, so that they might accuse him. And they questioned Yeshua, saying, "Is it permitted to heal on the Sabbath?" Guys, it was a setup. They were doing it on purpose. They brought the man in just so they could accuse him. And he looked at them and he said, "What man among you will not grab his sheep and lift it out if it falls in a pit on Shabbat? How much more valuable then is this man than a sheep? Therefore, it is permitted to good on Shabbat." Then he said to the man, "Stretch out your hand." And he stretched it out, and it was restored as healthy as the others. But the Pharisees went out and plotted against him how they might destroy him. He was showing and demonstrating that the higher law, the law of love and health, is what applies and is what is to be applied. And when he argued with them, he argued with them, even that was done in the Torah approved way. He cited examples from Torah. He cited examples from the prophets. He cited example after example and showed by citing example that there was a legal pattern, a legal precedence already set. A legal precedent. Do good on the Sabbath. It outweighs and it overlies any of the negative commandments. They argued at the time that Yeshua was alive whether or not, if you needed to have medicine, you could mix the medicine, you know, grind it, mix it, because medicine was mostly herbal at that time. That you, it kind of needed to be made fresh, right? So if someone is needing medicine, do you make it fresh that day, or do you have them, do you make it on Friday and have them take the stale herbs? And Yeshua is showing them health is important on the Sabbath. just being hungry and meeting that need, it's important on the Sabbath. The Sabbath is a special time. It's a holy day. It's been set up specifically for God, specifically so that we will honor Him. Looking at some verses that I have here, the one. So the question is then, how do we set the day apart? How do we set the day apart? I mean, it's one thing to say, let's honor the Sabbath, but when does it start? When does it end? All of that comes into play. Understand the traditional method, the traditional way it's done, is that you light a candle or light the candles on Friday evening. You see, the Word says that when He created, that there was more, that there was evening and morning, and that was the first day. So Shabbat, Sabbath, actually begins on what we call Friday evening. And it ends Saturday evening when three stars are visible in the sky. It's supposed to be about 25 hours. Now, during the winter, it may be a little longer because we have less daylight. But that's okay. If we rest a little longer, that's not a bad thing. There are three main rituals that are used regarding the Sabbath observance. The first one is to light the Sabbath candles. The second one is to say Kaddish over wine and recite the Hamotzi over Challah. Those are the three things that are required in order to bring Sabbath in. Light the candles, say Kaddish, recite Hamotzi over Challah. And these are things that we do. We're going to walk through some of the traditions, not all of them, just a few. We're going to demonstrate. There are multiple traditions that we can do, and then there are simple ways to do it, and even simplified. It's, you know, there's a place of understanding that each home is going to be a little different. Each family is going to be a little different. And where you have younger children, you might want a shorter version. Where you are older and you have more ability to have more extended time in worship, you can take the longer time. There are multiple places online on the in the computer where you can go to find Sabbath sitters, Sabbath seders, which is basically the order, and to figure it out from there. There are some that are more traditional in terms of more standard Judaism. There are some that are more modern. There's a wide variety. But again, there's three primary things for establishing the night. And then there's more things that can be added or taken away depending on what you have time for. Because this is Sabbath, because we're doing this in the middle of the day on the Sabbath, we we're going to be lighting from a pre-existing light source. I have a candle already over here burning, so we'll use that to help. But the very first thing is that the Sabbath candles are lit by the eldest woman in the house, usually. It means if you have grandma living with you, she gets to do it. In some households, they actually started putting candles up, a pair of candles up for each woman, each female, the oldest female child, and all of them actually, so that we are teaching as we go, so they learn also. But traditionally, it would be the eldest woman in the house. It's lit no later than 18 minutes before sundown on Friday night, which is before Sabbath begins. Before Sabbath begins. If you need to be reminded, if you need to know the time, the exact date, there's places online where you can go. You can sign up. I get an email every Friday. It comes in the morning in my email, and it tells me exactly what time I need to light the candles for our time zone. And you can get that through Chabad.org, the candle lighting. It's an important thing to be able to do, and so they want to make sure everyone gets to do it, candle lighting. Ugh. So first she lights the candles. Can't see what I'm doing. I said, because it's an existing light. So we light the candles first, but we don't get to look at them yet. Then we wave three times. One, two, three. Cover the eyes so that we don't see the candles burning. And then we say the blessing. Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam, Asher Kedeshanu B'Mitzvotav V'Tzivanu Lehiyot Or Legeyom, V'Natan Lanu Et Yeshua Mishachenu Or Haolam. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who sanctified us with your commandments and has commanded us to be a light to the nations, and who gave to us Jesus, our Messiah, the light of the world. I'm using a siddur from Hebrew for Christians, and it is a messianic siddur, which I appreciate. There is another blessing that says, Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam, Asher Kedeshanu B'Mitzvotav V'Tzivanu Lehadlek Ner Shel Shabbat. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who sanctifies us with your commandments and has commanded us concerning the kindling of the Sabbath light. Once the candle is lit, you can do a couple things once the candle is lit. Sometimes if there's a congregation that has a service on a Friday night, sometimes people will go ahead and go to that gathering, depending on how much time is there, and then come home to finish the rest. Sometimes they just sit around and sing some songs, but part of what is done next, before we eat the meal, is the blessing, to bless each other, because it's one thing to bless God, but it's another thing to begin to bless one another. The first blessing is usually the husband blessing the wife, out of Proverbs 31, verses 10 through 31. And this is considered a blessing.
An excellent wife who can find, for her worth is far above jewels. The heart of her husband trusts in her, and he will have no lack of gain. She does him good and not evil all the days of her life. She looks for wool and flax and works with her hands in delight. She is like merchant ships. She brings her food from afar. She rises also while it is still night and gives food to her household and portions to her maidens. She considers a field and buys it. From her earnings she plants a vineyard. She girds herself with strength and makes her arms strong. She senses that her gain is good. Her lamp does not go out at night. She stretches out her hands to the distaff, and her hands grasp the spindle. She extends her hands to the poor, and she stretches out her hands to the needy. She is not afraid of the snow for her household, for all her household are clothed with scarlet. She makes coverings for herself. Her clothing is fine linen and purple. Her husband is known in the gates when he sits among the elders of the land. She makes linen garments and sells them, and supplies belts to the tradesmen. Strength and dignity are her clothing, and she smiles at the future. She opens her mouth in wisdom, and the teaching of kindness is on her tongue. She looks well to the ways of her household, and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children rise up and bless her, her husband also, and he praises her, saying, many daughters have done nobly, but you excel them all. Charm is deceitful and beauty is vain, but a woman who fears the Lord, she shall be praised. Give her the product of her hands, and let her works praise her in the gates.
And then that, by the way, is often sung. You can look on YouTube and find out how to sing the blessing over your wife. And it's sung in Hebrew, But I think it's important for us to understand what it is that we're saying too. We need to know both. And then the woman can bless the husband. This is something that isn't in every siddur, but it is in mine. I like it this way. Because if he's going to bless you, then should we not return the blessing? Psalm 112 is the blessing that is read over the husband. Hallelujah. Happy is the man who fears Adonai, who delights greatly in his mitzvot. His offspring will be mighty in the land. The generation of the upright will be blessed. Wealth and riches are in his house, and his righteousness endures forever. Light shines in the darkness for the upright. Gracious, compassionate, and just is he. Good comes to the man who is gracious and lends. He will order his affairs with fairness. Surely he will never be shaken. The righteous are remembered forever, and he is not afraid of bad news. His heart is steadfast, trusting in Adonai. His heart is secure. He will not fear until he gazes upon his foes. He gives freely to the poor. His righteousness endures forever. His horn is lifted high in honor. The wicked will see it and be indignant. He will gnash with his teeth and waste away. The desire of the wicked will perish. And then there's the prayer of blessing over the children. The traditional blessing over the boys. Yeshimcha Elohim Ke Ephraim. Let's see. Yeah. Yeshimcha Elohim Ke Ephraim Viki Menesha. May God make you like Ephraim and Manasseh. And the blessing over the girls. And by the way, this is usually done. You put your hand on the girl, you put your hand on the boy. The blessing for our daughters, our sons and our daughters. The blessing for the daughters. Yeshimech Elohim Chesara, Rivka, Rachel, Ilea. May the Lord make you like Sarah, Rebecca, Rachel, and Leah. And for anyone else who is at the table, we would say the blessing, the Yevekrecha Adonai, Veishmerecha, Ya'er Adonai, Panav Elecha, Vechunecha. You see Adonai, Panav Elecha, Vayasim Lecha Shalom. Which basically says, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord shine his face to you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Everyone at the table is to be blessed. Then there is the blessing over the wine, the Kiddush. If I can stand up. We have grape juice. We cheat. In this way, we're very Protestant, I guess. I'm going to go ahead and pour some grape juice. Just a little tiny bit, guys. Craig and Janie, if you wouldn't mind. You like just a little, right? Okay. I'd have you come sit on the pillows up here, but that would be a little uncomfortable, I think. Getting up and down is the hard part, right? That's kind of where I'm at. Okay, getting up and down. Can I keep doing this? Yes, I can do this. Okay. The blessing over the wine. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech ha'olam, borei pri hagafen. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine. And everyone says, Amen. Then there's even more of a blessing. Blessed are you, Lord, our God, King of the universe, who sanctified us with his commandments and was pleased with us in his holy Sabbath. In love and in favor he guided us, gave us a memorial of the work of creation, for it is the day opening to convocations holy, a memorial of the Exodus from Egypt. For us did you choose, and us did you sanctify from all the nations. With your holy Sabbath, with love, with favor, you have guided us. Blessed are you, Lord our God, who sanctifies the Sabbath. Amen. And when the blessing is recited, then we drink the wine from the Kiddush cup. In many households, there is one cup and it's shared around the table. And no, the cup is not broken. That's at the marriage. No, the cup is not broken. Aha, that was where it went. Okay. I was supposed to read another one first, and I'm like, where did it go? Now I know where it went. Okay. Kaddish means sanctification, and the blessing is said over the wine or the grape juice on all Shabbat or festivals. Kaddish is recited while holding the cup, usually by the head of the household. The blessing begins, though, with Genesis 1:31-2:3, and it ends with thanks to God for the gift of the Sabbath. And the evening and the morning were the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the host of them. And on the seventh day, God ended his work which he had made. And he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had made. And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because in it he rested from all his work which he created. Then you do the blessing over the wine. I knew I was forgetting something. I was turning the page the wrong direction. Now, in many homes, and we don't do this here, but I'm going to explain it to you anyway. Directly after reciting Kaddish, everyone washes their hands in a prescribed manner. Now, it's not a hand washing to clean your hands. It's more of a hand washing to rinse them off, to remind us of the fact that we are priests before God, and before the priests offered up their sacrifices, they washed their hands. And so there's the hand washing. Usually it's a large cup is brought with 4 or 5 ounces of water. You take one hand and you pour over the other 3 times, front and back, over the other 3 times, front and back. There are special hand washing cups that can be used that have 2 handles, so the water is made even easier. But literally, it's just a ceremonial washing. Before we do it, our hands should already be clean. Traditionally, when you're washing the hands, once the wine has been blessed, not a word can be spoken next until the bread is blessed. So the washing of the hands is something that is done in silence. The first prayer is gone. Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Asher Kiddushani B'Mitzvotav V'Tzivanu Al Netilat Yadayim. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who sanctified us with the commandments and has commanded us about washing our hands. And so they wash the hands in silence, and we don't speak again until the bread is brought out. We take the cover off. We have 2 loaves. I want to make sure I don't get burnt. Okay. There are 2 loaves of bread, the challah. You lift the 2 loaves of bread. And in this it says that the head of the household draws a knife across the challah, making an indication as to where we're going to cut. I was taught that we never cut challah. The challah is broken because it said it was broken. It's broken for you. And so I was taught and trained that we don't cut challah. We break off pieces of it. So again, there's different traditions in different places. There's always 2 loaves because of the double blessing that God gives us. We've been told that if we will prepare properly on Friday, God will give us the manna we need for both Friday and Shabbat, right? So the sixth day, we collect double. We have double the loaves of bread. The double blessing that God gives us. It also helps remind us, just like the candles do, that we light them to remember and to keep the dual command of Sabbath. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam, Hamotzi lachem min haaretz. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who brings forth bread from the earth. And so then we break off a piece of bread. The head of the household will break a piece of bread off for himself. As I find the bread. Aha, there it is. Hey, that's okay. I like challah. I like Janie's challah too. There you go. And then what's next is something that a lot of times gets forgotten, but you salt. You take the salt and you either dip your bread in the salt or you sprinkle your bread with a little bit of salt. And the challah is passed around. The salt is used to remember and commemorate the sacrifices in the temple. You see, every sacrifice required salt before it could be offered. And because this is, we are experiencing the temple of God, we salt our bread. That in, it's an enhancement of taste, and so we want to really enhance our taste. And then we get to eat the challah. Mmm. I like good challah. The Friday night meal is normally eaten then after the synagogue service, Kabbalah Shabbat. It usually has fish, soup, chicken, meat, whatever. It's to be a festive meal. It's to be dressed up for. It's to be brought with joy. It's to be the best of the week. So I remember on Sundays, we always had a nice roast. Mom would put it in the oven before we left for church. We'd come home and there was the roast to be ready. And we always had the best meal of the week was on Sunday. Well, guess what? In Jewish traditions, the best meal of the week is Shabbat, Sabbath evening. As we gather around, as we have the lit candles, as we enjoy the time together, a lot of times during that time, you can discuss things of God with your family. You know how the Bible tells us that we are supposed to raise up our children. We're supposed to teach them when we walk, when we do this, when we do all these things. Well, the Sabbath meal is a perfect time to talk about God with your family, to talk about that week's Torah portion, the one that's going to be read the next morning in the service. It's called Divrei Torah. And often, there's table songs. I was trained that it was okay to sing at a meal. Now, Craig's mother, that was totally forbidden. We don't sing at the table. I got in trouble for that when we were young married because I didn't know that rule. In our household, we told jokes. We talked. We sang. We had fun. We enjoyed our meals. And this is true of the Sabbath evening. Some of those songs include a couple of the ones that we did tonight, the Shalom Aleichem, the Shabbat Shalom, you know, Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat, 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 Shalom. And quite often it's done with wine. So everyone's drinking, the adults are drinking the wine. They're singing the songs. They're dancing. It's a celebration of God. And there's other songs as well that you can look up, you can learn, you can practice, you can understand, you can add to your own time. Good challah. Sabbath is supposed to be a joy. The word says, taste and see that the Lord is good. This is part of that. You'll notice that as we began, before we ate, we did not, quote, say grace. That when we bless, we're not blessing the food. We're blessing God. We're blessing God who provided the grapes for the wine. We're blessing God who provided the bread. We're blessing God, not the food. In fact, in Judaism, grace is said after the meal. After the meal. Before we bless God for provision. Afterwards, we sing a grace song. We sing blessing to the Lord and we thank him for all that he's done. Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, hazan et haolam kulo betavro. I'm not going to read the whole thing in Hebrew. You can look it up. You can listen to it if you go to HebrewForChristians.com, and it's Hebrew, the number four, Christians.com. You can go to the Sabbath Seder Guide, and you can click on the little button, and they will sing it for you. You will hear it prayed in the chanting that it's supposed to be done. It will be cantored for you, and you can learn it that way. But in English, this is what it says. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who nourishes the whole world in goodness, with grace, kindness, and compassion. He gives bread to all flesh. His mercy endures forever. And through his great goodness we have never lacked, nor will we lack food forever, for the sake of his great name. For he is God who nourishes and sustains all, and does good to all, and prepares food for all of his creatures, which he has created. Blessed are you, Lord, who nourishes all. Amen. Of the various berachot, or the blessings, there is another one that is extremely important that we like to remember, especially on Sabbath. And like all of them, it begins with the Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given to us a way of salvation through Messiah Yeshua. Blessed be he. Amen and amen. And then you get to have the special day, the Sabbath day before the Lord. There's special services. There's gathering together for joint prayers. The day is spent with family and friends, sometimes taking a nap, just relaxing. Some families will take a walk on the Sabbath day, visit other people. Torah study is encouraged. Just enjoy the day. Do what causes you to be relaxed before God in a way that honors him. Keep eating. There's another ceremony then at the very end of the day, at sunset, once you've seen three stars in the sky, and that's important. Have to be able to see the stars in the sky. If you're unsure as to when that would be, you can get the same information. The Sabbath lights will send you both the time to start and the time to end. They'll give you the Havdalah time. The Havdalah ceremony is a separation ceremony recited at the end of the Sabbath. It helps, again, to mark the distinction between the sacred day and the ordinary day. As we lit candles to bring in Sabbath, to mark it as a sacred day, we're going to light a different candle to make it the end of the day. The Havdalah ceremony begins with a number of Bible verses that commemorate God's salvation. Behold, God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid. For the Lord Adonai is my strength and my song. He also has become my salvation. Therefore, with joy shall you draw waters out of the wells of salvation. Isaiah 12, 2 through 3. Psalm 116, 13 is also often recited. I will take the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. Again, there is the blessing over wine. This time, as it's done a little differently. When they pour the cup, they pour it as full as possible. As full as possible. In fact, in some families, it's a special cup that's used. It sits on a saucer, and you literally pour the wine in until it overflows just slightly into the saucer. And you bless it, but you don't drink it yet. Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam borei pari hagafen. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine. Because next, we take a box of spices. Where do I have? There it is. Which I have over here. This is my spice box. Very simple. Something I got at the dollar store. You know, it doesn't have to cost you a fortune to be able to celebrate God. You can do it with things that are simple. In the spice box are some pretty smelling spices. The spices usually used are cloves, cinnamon, bay leaves, sweet smelling spices. Did you know that smell is one of the first senses that you develop? And it's one of the last senses to be gone. Smelling the spices is to help distinguish a special fragrance from the more ordinary. Part of the reason why we have the boxes to also to remember the separation of the sacred from the profane. This following blessing is said. I'll just say the English. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, creator of all spices. And it's passed around the table. And in some families, the tradition is this, that as you smell the spices, you're remembering the beauty of the Sabbath day. And you can share a story. And everyone who smells the spices says what was their favorite part of the Sabbath. What was your favorite part of Sabbath? And we smell the spices to help carry the scent of the beauty of Sabbath with us into the rest of the week. Then there's another candle that is lit. Remember, this is after sunset, so you can light you don't have to light from a pre-existing source, but this one I will. The Havdalah candle represents light, the first element created by God at the very beginning of the first week. Lighting this candle becomes the first act of work that is permitted during the regular week. And I don't have the right holder to hold this up, so I can only do part of it. So you would light the candle from a match because you're doing work. And this represents the first work. Because this is still Sabbath, I'm going to go ahead and light from the existing flame. Notice it's multiple wicks. Multiple wicks that join together to form one flame. Just like we are multiple people, but when we join together to worship God, we create one flame of love before God, one flame, one light. You're supposed to take your hand and hold it close to the front flame. Look for the reflection in your fingernails or the shadow on your palm, recognizing the light by which we can work with our hands in the world around us. And the following blessing is said. Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech HaOlam, Borei Me'orei Ha'esh. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, creator of the fire. Using only the light of the Kiddush candle, only the light of the Havdalah candle, and so in normal homes, you would turn off all the lights now, and just using this light, recite over the Kiddush cup of wine only from this light. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who separates the holy from the profane, the light from the darkness, Israel from the nations, the seventh day from the 6 days of labor. Blessed are you, Lord our God, who separates between the holy and the profane. Amen. After the blessing is complete, we take a little bit of the wine from the Kiddush cup. We pour a little bit of it onto the plate. Then we drink the cup of wine together. Everyone drinks. And finally, when everyone has had their Kiddush wine, everyone has drunk it, the Havdalah candle is put out by dipping it into the wine cup and listening to it sizzle with the last of the wine. I don't have the right kind of cup here, and I didn't think about this part of the ceremony, so I'm just going to have to blow out this particular candle. But usually what you want to do is put it out in the wine cup. Oh! And now we have a smoke detector go off, right? As the room is now dark, because remember we turned off the lights, we've just blown out the only light, then we sing a song.
Eliyahu Hanavi, Eliyahu Hatishbi, Eliyahu, Eliyahu, Eliyahu Hagladi.
Basically, the song is calling for Elijah to come. Why? Because when Elijah comes, he precedes Messiah, and we are calling in Messiah. Then the lights are turned back on, and we can look at each other, and we can say, Shavua Tov. Have a good week. Shavua Tov. Good week to you. Good week to you. When we keep Sabbath, we are reminded of God's creation. When we keep Sabbath, we are reminded that Sabbath is the first thing he ever blessed. Do we want to walk in his blessing? Sabbath remembers the Exodus from Egypt because he says, I have freed you from slavery so that you may serve me. Sabbath is the number four of the Ten Commandments. Remember I said it's that hinge commandment. It blesses both, it causes us to bless both God and bless each other. It puts it together. Jesus and his disciples celebrated Shabbat. Paul celebrated Shabbat. If you don't know where that is, you can send me an email or you can call me and ask. Sabbath provides a means of identification for us to identify with the Jewish people, the special people of God. Learning about Sabbath improves our literacy in history and in Judaism and in the worship of God. It helps us to be a more effective witness to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And remember always, Sabbath is a delight. It's a joy, not a burden. It's a time to celebrate our personal rest in Messiah Yeshua. As in all of it, we remember our works do not bring us salvation. How we keep Sabbath is not going to distinguish whether or not we are believers, whether or not we make it into heaven. That's not what it's about. It's about honoring the God who has given us salvation. Because he's freed us from the world, we can take at least one day a week and honor and serve him. And that is what Sabbath is about, honoring and serving him. Father, thank you for today. Thank you for this time. Thank you for what we've learned. Thank you, Father, for all of it. I ask that you would be blessed, glorified, magnified. That it is about you and about our wanting and our desire to honor you. Thank you, Father, for what you've given, for what we are able to do. And I ask that you would bring more, that you would bring more to honor you. In the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, our Lord and our Savior. Amen and amen.